talk about memory a little bit. Because we are living in a time that memory is becoming this terrible thing that we easily forget. We forget more than we can remember. So this is where I'm going to talk about a concept called cognitive offloading. A couple of months ago, an article in the Guardian spoke about this term called cognitive offloading. It said, we have transferred all the burden that we should be taking on as human beings to think, to remember, and then transferring it onto the computer. It was just the other day, I had this favorite movie, and I couldn't remember what the movie was, but I knew it won the Oscar 2 years ago, 3 years ago, I don't know. It had a mute woman in it, so immediately I got on Google, I type Oscar, dumb woman, enter, and suddenly I get The Shape of Water. This is what we are doing in our lives every day. And I'm sure all of you are doing this. Every time you don't remember who said this quote, you immediately go online and research. So that's when I felt this novel by a young writer, debutant. Her name is Felicia Yap, a Malaysian author. She's a university professor. She's a cat lover, a lot of things. She wrote a book called Yesterday, where people in the book, the characters in the book, can only remember what happened yesterday. So the society in this novel is divided into two different people, and they are the monos and the duos. The monos can remember up to 24 hours from the past, and the duos 48 hours. And so the gap is between these monos and duos, and the duos of course are far more superior than the monos. Who are like these weak, illiterate people, you know, they're living because they can't remember anything past the last 24 hours. And I was thinking, what major difference does it really make if one can remember 24 or 48 hours? Turns out, it does a lot more. It does a lot more than we can actually think about. Now, what is going to happen if you only remember yesterday? So suppose I come to you and I ask you, what did you do yesterday? What did you do the day before yesterday? What about the day before that? That's when it gets really difficult to start thinking. You know, and I suddenly ask you, what were you doing on the 23rd of October? Because I had an experience. I was at another presentation, and suddenly I get this phone call from a police officer saying, did you come anywhere near Pathanamthitta on 20th of November? And I said, 20th of November? And I'm thinking. And he said, I'm not sure. And I said, are you sure? Because I think your car might have been somewhere. And I'm like, I don't think I took my car anywhere near Pathanamthitta. In fact, I haven't been to Pathanamthitta in the last 6 months. And I'm thinking, am I so sure? Because I can't be sure. But if you ask my grandmother this question, she'll be like, what? No! Certainly not! And she would have this adamant expression on her face because she clearly remembers. Because she's not plagued by technology. She's not plagued by this memory loss, which is due to this onset of so much information running out of my head. I don't know what to retain. So I think that's what Felicia Yap is trying to tap into. Because the novel is set in 2016. I expected it to be something in 2028. Or somewhere in 4000. No, it is set in 2016, where the people, all of them, including Steve Jobs or Berners-Lee, everyone are dual, all the smart ones are dual. And the reader does not know. Should I consider myself to be a dual? And that's when we meet all the characters. I mean, there are really four of them. There are four narrators. One is Sophia, and we're listening to a dead woman. We begin with a dead woman. And then we have Hans, who is a mono detective masquerading as a duo, because monos will never climb up this hierarchy. And now think again, the post-human, there's still hierarchy there, and the hierarchy of memory. Then we move on to Claire, who's a mono, who's married to Mark, and now Mark is a novelist. So we have all four people talking to us, taking turns, and the funny thing is, we don't know who to trust, because all of them have elusive memories. All of them have to look at their eye diaries, it's something like an iPad, of course, owned by Steve Jobs in 1995, that's what the book says. And they will write down everything in the diary as soon as the day ends because they need to remember it the next day. So the next morning, they will look at it, they will look at the facts and say, okay, yesterday I wore a red dress to prom. And that is going to be stuck in their head. And this is what I'm going to ask you. What is the most traumatizing memory that you've had? And you'll probably tell me, the one time I almost drowned in the river. And you'll say, what were you wearing that day? And I would probably say, I was wearing this blue t-shirt and white shorts and I decided to take a swim, although I didn't know how to swim. And then what happened? What kind of weather was it? It was a sunny day. The birds were chirping, it wasn't going to rain. So you're going to give me graphic details of what is probably going to happen. But the people in this book cannot do that. They're probably going to say, let me quickly check my diary. And they're going to go back and say, okay, I think I was wearing a red dress. What about the weather? I did not write down what the weather was. I cannot say. And we keep hearing about Sophia. Sophia is a woman who died. And Sophia is a woman with a superpower. She can remember everything. And here, this superpower is not considered to be a superpower because she is tormented by it. And it is this torment. And why does she remember everything? It's mostly because of a trauma she had. She hits her head when she falls, when she has an argument with Mark, who she is dating at the moment. She hits her head, and because of that trauma, she can recollect everything. And then she notes in her diary, I can remember everything, but whatever I remember is fuzzy. And the other people, the normal people who cannot remember anything more than 48 hours, they think, how can someone remember fuzzy things? It should be facts you remember. It should be that I am married to this man, and I married him in 1995 on December 17th. I was wearing a red dress, and I promised myself that I'm going to love him forever and ever. And it is with this thought that they wake up every morning, the husband and wife looks at each other and says, I love you, and he says, I love you back. They don't remember anything that happened the fight that happened 2 weeks ago. So much confusion because we can remember everything and we don't understand to be in that position because if we find someone like Madhavi Mantha, we're probably going to put him in the lunatic side. That's what we normally do because we're less sympathetic to the people who we know can't remember. They're no longer a part of us. Bringing me back again to how Yap has tried to portray this because she has quite interesting narrative techniques. I mean, she puts newspaper clippings in between for the reader to understand the world that they're living in. So one such newspaper article says, 10 things that would happen if we were living in a world where people would remember everything. And the first one is, relationships with families would vary very differently because if you're in a relationship and you remember everything, it's going to become boring. Of course, it's going to become so boring and repetitive because come on, you're waking up the same person every day, you know what they wore, you know what they smell like, you know what cologne they like, what roses they like. It's so repetitive. So adultery would become more rampant, which is true, I think. Adultery is on the rise, our world is on the rise. Could I agree with that? Secondly, if you could remember everything, the experiences related to the memory is going to propagate the emotions that you have. Is it love? Is it hate? Especially hate. But there's a strong point in hate there. Hate, she says, or the need for vengeance is the sum total of all the grievances that you have amassed in your journey. And if you cannot remember, you cannot hate. And it is because Sophia can remember that she has so much vengeance. She has so much vengeance towards Mark because Mark caused her the trauma which makes her remember. The reason for her trying to kill Mark, trying to destroy his political career is only because he made her remember everything. She does not have the liberty to forget. She is not exempt from not knowing, like we all are. Maybe you know everything, but all the bad things we have done in the past. Even if you try to crush a butterfly or you try to kill a puppy and you don't want anyone to know, you know, deep down it still hurts you. So this is a quote from the book which says, the problem with being able to remember everything is that you don't remember all of it, which is also a problem because we are catching on to something and then we love the memory so much that we want to hear more and more about it. We make it even more beautiful than it really is. So towards the second half of the book, even after Claire, the Mona wife, finds out that he has been cheating on her, she tries to forgive him. Because they go back to the memories that they have typed into the diary and they find out the real reason why they have loved each other. And that's when, as superhumans who can remember everything, we thank our memories. Because this is the exact same reason why we stay in relationships and we love and we fight and we have hate and all those emotions that make us finally human. So to conclude, to think about what happens in yesterday and to apply it to where we are now, I think the book gives us an opportunity to look at things from perspective, and memory plays a role. It allows us to see, so as a person who's gifted this power, how different it would be if we were actually going to a situation where we can't remember anything. And right now we are on that day because we don't know the number of folk, how many numbers do we know by heart? How many addresses do we know by heart? Because everything is given to us at our fingertips. When we talk about post-human, when we talk about biologically augmented, beautiful looking human beings who are constantly trying to achieve something, they don't even know what it is, but they're trying to achieve something, something more than themselves, something superhuman. We're actually, knowingly or unknowingly, trying to dumb down the faculties that we already have, trying to detach ourselves from what we really are, trying so hard to become something we don't know, we might become extinct in the whole process. But what if there is something that keeps us at the end utterly human? It is memory and the after effects of it. Thank you.
I'm sorry, I should have already introduced you properly because you are my student, and so I took the privilege of calling you simply by calling you Ashwita. She's Ashwita, she's the first ever student of this college, and so happy for you. And now, again, I have to invite our former student and now the assistant professor of Government College, Kolhapur.